Hello friends, welcome to Geology Concepts. In this video, we'll be discussing the GATE 2020 Geology section of the GG paper. And I got the feedback that paper was quite a bit on the numerical side, which is true. It was definitely tougher than the last year exam. So we would expect the cutoff to go less this time, maybe around 33, 32. So nevertheless, you have to solve all the questions. So in this video, we'll solve all the questions one by one and see the approach in solving different questions. Okay, so let's start. First question here says, group is a fairly easy question, straightforward. Group is a unit of, so of course it is the unit of lithostratigraphy. Formation, group, member, bed, these all are units of lithostratigraphy. Like for chronostratigraphy, the units are era, epoch, stage, right, series. This is chronostratigraphy. So the answer will be 4. This question is from the seismic part of the geophysics section. If alpha and beta are p and s wave velocity respectively, then the value of this expression, which is alpha square minus 4 by 3, can be anything, but this expression you have to calculate. So to solve this question, you should know that what is alpha, means what is p wave velocity in terms of k and mu. So alpha is given by under root k plus 4 by 3 mu divided by rho, and similarly beta is given by under root mu by rho. Okay, so mu is shear modulus. We know in shear wave there is no compression, so there is no k in the expression of S wave. Now we just need to square it. So from here we'll get alpha square is equal to k plus, I can write it k by rho plus 4 by 3 into mu by rho. I'm just taking, I'm just taking density with the both the terms. Also beta square will be equal to mu by rho, right? Now I want to, in the expression it is given 4 by 3 beta square. So what I'm doing, I'm taking the value of 4 by 3 only. So if I multiply this by 4 by 3, this becomes 4 by 3 mu by rho, right? Now look at this equation 1, and this is equation 2. Now if I do equation 1 minus 2, I'll get this expression on the left hand side. So if I do 1 minus 2, I'll get alpha square minus 4 by 3 beta square. Now this will be equal to, if I write it, it will be k by rho plus 4 by 3 mu by rho minus 4 by 3 mu by rho. Right? So this will get cancelled. You will be left with k by rho only. So answer in this case will be k by rho. Okay. Let's go to the next question. Well, you can also do this question by seeing units, right? If you know the unit of bulk modulus and the final unit should be in terms of unit of velocity squared, then by that also you can see that only this expression will satisfy that. Okay. So, okay, let's go to the next question. Now this says, the mole percentages of SiO2, Al2O3 and K2O in a granitic rock. So if you see these three percentages, if you add them, it amounts to 99.99. Okay? That means the whole of the rock contains only these three components, granitic rock. Okay. So the easier way to do is, let's assume, let total moles be 100. In the rock be 100, right? So you will get away with the percentages. You can directly write the number of SiO2 moles will be, it will be 84.21. okay, then the number of Al2O3 moles will be 7.89, and the number of K2O moles will be also 7.89. Now the question is asking the molar proportion of K feldspar. So the only thing that you need to know to solve this question is the expression of K feldspar or the chemical formula of K feldspar. So because it is oftenly used, most of us know, right, that K feldspar is KAlSi3O8. Right? If you don't know this, then this question is difficult to solve. But if you know this, it's fairly easy. K feldspar, you know this. Now you can write it in terms of oxide also. Right? You can write it half K2O. Right? Half Al2O3 and 3SiO2. I mean, this is the expression or K feldspar written in the form of oxides. Now what you can see here is the ratio they are combining is in the ratio of 1:1:6. I mean, if you take 1 mole of K2O and take 1 mole of Al2O3 and 6 moles of SiO2, then you can form 2 moles of KAlSi3O8. And also see here, this is K2O, right? So you mean you require half moles. So this is very important. You require half moles of K2O to make 1 mole of KAlSi3O8. That means whatever be the number of K2O in the system, you will make the you will be able to or double of that. You can make K feldspar amounting to double of the moles of K2O, right? So if you go to the question, there is 7.89 moles of K2O. That means the number of moles of KAlSi3O8 you will be able to make will be 2 × 7.89, right? Because there is K2 and in feldspar there is only 1K. So for every mole of K2O, you will get 2 moles of K feldspar. So for 7.89, you will get 2 × 7.89, which is 15.74 or 15.78 moles. Okay. So these are the number of moles of K feldspar that we'll make. The point is ki for making these many moles, right, how much SiO2 will be required? So you see the ratio is 1:1:6. That means if you're using 1 mole of K2O, you will require 6 moles of SiO2. Now the total moles of K2O is this 7.89. So whatever SiO2 that you will require in making this K feldspar, these many moles of K feldspar will be 6 times of this number, 6 times of 7.89, right? Now this, if you calculate, will come out to be 47.34 moles, right? The point is ki there were total 84.21 moles. So what is the number of moles that are left? So left SiO2, that will be 84.21 minus 47.34, which is 36.87. Okay, so now consider this. In this system, let's say this was your rock in which there are only two components, right? You have K feldspar, right, and you have quartz. Quartz means SiO2. You have 15.78 moles of K feldspar and you have 36.87 moles of quartz, right? So it is, in the question it is asking the molar proportion of K feldspar. So molar proportion will be percentage molar K feldspar. Now it's easy. Number of moles of K feldspar, which is 15.78, divide by the total moles. Now total moles will be 15.78 plus 36.87. If you add this, you will get 5.62. So you'll get 52.65. Now it is asking in percentage, multiply it with 100. So if you solve this, you'll get 29.9%. So this will be the answer. 29.9%. Okay. So in this question, what it is asking you basically to know this ratio 1:1:6, and of course the percentage of how do you calculate the molar percentage, which is whatever it is asking upon total moles into 100. Okay, now this is an easy question from structural geology. It says there is a vertical borehole that is in the shale, right? So let's say this is the horizontal ground and this is your shale bed, right? It is saying if you drill a vertical hole like this, right? So it is 5 meter deep and this angle is given to be 60 degrees. It is asking you what will be the true thickness, right? The borehole pierces through the shale bed. Now through the shale bed it is piercing through for a length of 10 meter to reach the sandstone layer below. So this is 10 meters and below this there, so this is shale and this is sandstone. So after this 10 meters it goes below and encounters the sandstone bed. Now it is asking you the true thickness. This will be the true thickness of the shale bed, right? Now the question becomes fairly easy because you know this angle is 60 degrees, so this will be 30 and this will be 60. Now this length is 10 meters, this length will be 10 cos 60, this length 10 cos 60 degrees. You solve this, cos 60 is half, so this will come out to be 5 meters, right? So the true thickness of the shale bed here will be 5 meters. Easy question. Now this question is also based on geometry. It says there is a sketch which is showing a triangular rock mass ABC. Now see, this ABC is a triangular rock mass which is resting on this AC joint plane, right? Now AC joint plane is dipping at an angle 35 degrees because the 35 dip is the angle that it makes with the horizontal. Now to hold this rock mass at its place, a rock bolt is being pierced through this, right? So a rock bolt which is going like this will hold this mass together, right? And the force that is exerting will be along the axis like this, and this is given to be 110 kilonewton. Okay, kilonewton. Now it is asking whatever force this rock bolt is applying on this AC joint plane, what will be the shear component of it, right? The absolute value of the shear force along the joint plane, right? So how do you know this? How to find it? If this is the direction of the force that is exerted by the bolt, you need to take this component, right? There will be two components. One component will be perpendicular and one component will be parallel to the AC plane. The perpendicular component is the normal force, or you can say the compression, but the shear will be along the parallel component. So you have to calculate this value. To calculate this value, you should know this angle. Now the only thing remains here is to find out this angle. So let's see, if I draw a horizontal line here, let's say I'm drawing a horizontal line like this, right? Now because this angle is 35 degrees, this angle will be, this is the dip, right? So this angle will be 35. Now if this is 35, this angle will be 35, right? And this angle is 25, it is given, so this will be 25. So this whole angle, this part is 35 and this part is 25. That means total angle is 60 degrees, right? So you have to take the cos component of this 110. So this shear will be, this shear force will be 110 kilonewton cos 60, right? So it will be 110 into cos 60 is again half, So it is 55 kilonewton. So here answer will be 55 kilonewtons. Okay. So easy question again. You should know the how to take the component, and that's it. That's pretty much it. Now, in reduction of gravity data, the latitude correction is maximum at. See, you should know, for solving this question, you should know what is the latitude correction, because latitude correction is given by 0.8140 sine 2 lambda. Now this is very important. 2 lambda. Now this 2 lambda is the thing that you need to know to maximize the value of this expression. Because you see, it is asking that will have when at what latitude will be maximum. This expression will only be maximum when sine 2 lambda becomes 1, because the maximum value of sine is 1, right? So sine 2 lambda will become 1. That will be the position where this correction will be maximum. So sine 2 lambda is 1, that means 2 lambda should be 90, because sine 90 is 1, and lambda will be 45. Easy question. Lambda should be 45 degrees. Easy, fairly easy question. The stage of textural maturity of clay-rich sandstone. Clay-rich, this is the condition of a sandstone being immature, containing poorly sorted, that means still immature, and angular framework. See, the more rounded the grain is, more sorted, and more, let's say, less amount of clay, that much mature the rock is. So all these three conditions is pointing towards the rock being immature. Okay. This is a good question. It says the first and second dissociation constants of H2CO3 is this and this respectively. If the concentration of H2CO3 is 1 molar, so this is given. Concentration of H2CO3 is given. pH is given. And sigma CO2 in the solution, you have to ask. They are asking you have to calculate total CO2. See what happens is the CO2 in the atmosphere that gets dissolved in the water, right, and converts into H2CO3, right? Now it's saying H2CO3 is further dissociating. H2CO3, when it dissociates, there are two components. Converts into a bicarbonate ion, HCO3 minus, plus a H plus, right? And then some of the H2CO3 or HCO3 minus, sorry, some of the bicarbonate along further, it converts into carbonate ion plus an H plus, right? So now if this is, let's say this is your system. Now inside the system, you will have some amount of H2CO3. Some amount of HCO3 minus and some carbonate, right? So whatever CO2 that has come into the system will exist in these three species, in the form of these three species. So it is asking you the total CO2 in the solution will be the total concentration of all this, right, in the form of molar. So total concentration you have to calculate. So for that, see, H2CO3 they have given only that it is 1 molar. Right, H2CO3 is 1 molar. Now you have to calculate how much will be the bicarbonate, right? So for that we need to know the K of this reaction, which is given here. So K, or the rate constant or the reaction quotient, will be 6.671 into 10 raised to the power minus 7. This should be equal to the product side, which is concentration of bicarbonate into H plus concentration, and divided by H2CO3 concentration. This is the expression. Now see, it is given in the question that the pH is 6. Now what is pH? pH is defined as minus log H plus concentration. Right, this is given to be 6. So from here, if you solve, you will get H plus concentration as 10 raised to the power minus 6, right, molar. This is the concentration, right? So you can put this value here. From here we will get So value of H plus is 10 raised to power minus 6. H2CO3 is 1. That is given in the question. So expression becomes HCO3 minus the value of this concentration comes out to be 6.761 into 10 raised to the power minus 7 divided by 10 raised to the power minus 6. This is H plus. H2CO3 is 1. So from here, if you calculate, you will get 0.6761 molal. So this is the concentration of bicarbonate. Now from bicarbonate, some of the bicarbonate will dissociate further into carbonate and H plus. So again, we can write the expression for carbonate dissociation or bicarbonate dissociation. It will be 4.68 into 10 raised to the power minus 11 equal to, this will be equal to concentration of carbonate into concentration of H plus, which is 10 raised to the power minus 6, and divided by HCO3 minus, we have recently calculated 0.6761. Right. So from here, if you calculate carbonate CO3 minus 2, this will be 4.68 into 10 raised to the power minus 5 divided by 0.6761. So this value is coming very, very less, 0.000 something, 3 at the last. So this is a very, very less value. So we can say that carbonate in the system is negligible, right? So total CO2 in the system will be the 1 molal of H2CO3, 0.6761 molal of bicarbonate, and CO3 minus 2, this is very less, so you can neglect here. So total thing will be 1 plus 0.6761. So it will be 1 point, total will be 1 plus this. So 1.6761. What I have done, I have added this 1 plus this. So this is the total thing that is there. I am not adding carbonate because it is very, very less. As you can see, the dissociation constant is also very small. That means this SCO3 will not go that much into carbonate. So this is very less. So mostly bicarbonate. And this also you can see from the expression that at around pH of 6 and 7, the maximum concentration will be of H2CO3 and bicarbonate. If you increase the pH, then only this bicarbonate will convert into carbonate. So the main contribution will be from these two species. So this is how you do this question. Next. Okay, so now the ninth question. It says the radius of an oblate spheroid is 45 degree. At 45 degrees, with ellipticity of polar flattening 1/298.25, an equatorial radius of this meter is this much kilometers. So if you see polar flattening, so if you take the equatorial radius to be A, right, and the polar radius to be B, polar flattening will be given by A minus B upon B. This is equal to 1/298.25. Okay. So you know the value of A, which is given in the question. This is A, equatorial radius. If you put that value here, you can calculate B. So if you calculate B from here, it will come out to be 6356 826 meters. This is the value that you can calculate. So now the question says that find out the radius at 45 degree latitude. So you have to calculate radius at this latitude. This is 45 degrees, right? So how to solve this question? Now you just need to find out this distance, or let's say this radius. So any point, this is a general thing that I'm saying, any point on the ellipse, means on the any point on the ellipse will satisfy this equation. X square upon A square plus Y square upon B square is equal to 1. Now this is an expression for ellipse. Let me write it here. x square upon a square plus y square upon b square is equal to 1. Now what I mean by that is, any point, if you take it on ellipse, x and y component of it, see, one point will be x, other will be y, abscissa and ordinate will satisfy this equation, right? So generally I can write, if I take one point as a cos theta, another point is b sin theta, right? This is a general point that can be taken on an ellipse, because the maximum length of x can go to plus a to minus a, and b can also go from plus b to minus b. So cos theta and sin theta are, you know, the maximum value is 1 and minus 1. So they can easily be used to, generalize these points. Because at this point theta will be 0. So a cos theta will be, this point will be a, and this point b sin theta, sin 0 will be 0. So this will be a comma 0, right? So now it is saying theta is 45 degree. In the question, it is asking you to find the r at length 45 degree. So this point will become a by root 2. Cos 45 degrees 1 upon root 2, right? A by root 2, and this will become b 45 degree or b by root 2, right? Because sine 45 is 1 upon root 2. Now you just need to find the distance of origin 0 comma 0 and between these points. So if you solve it, under root this r will be equal to under root a by root 2 whole squared plus b by a root 2 whole squared, right? Now you know the value of a also here and b also. If you solve this from here, your r will come out to be, now it is asking kilometers, so I directly tell you the answer. It will be 6367.4 kilometers. Okay, it will be around this, so that will be the answer, 6367.4 kilometers. Let me just calculate it also once more, so that, you know, it gets confirmed. Can be 6366.789 kilometers. So this will be the more precise answer here. Okay, 6366.78 kilometers. Okay, next question. So in this question, it is asking you the heat flux at the Earth's surface is 60 milliwatt per meter square. If the thermal conductivity at the surface is 2.5 watt per meter per degree Celsius, you have to find the geothermal gradient. So this is the Earth's surface, right? It is radiating heat. Let's say this area is 1 meter square, so it is radiating heat from here, right? 60 milliwatts. So I can write 60 into 10 raised to the power minus 3 watts per meter square. And this is like Q means the total heat flux that is coming, right? This Q will be directly proportional to the temperature gradient, whatever be the temperature difference. Let's say here the temperature is T1 and here temperature is T2, and T2 is high, T1 is low, so heat will flow in this direction from high to low. So this flow, the rate of this flow will depend on this gradient. If this T2 is very high, the rate of flow will be high, mean the difference. That means the gradient, which is dt by dl, this dl is this length, right? The gradient is actually change in any quantity with change in distance. So this will be dt by dl. This is your thermal gradient, right? So this you have to calculate. So if you remove this proportionality constant, here there will be thermal conductivity. Let's say we call it k. This is similar like Darcy's law, in that there is hydraulic conductivity, but here it is thermal conductivity. So now you have to calculate this value of dt by dl. So q is 60 into 10 raised to the power minus 3 is equal to 2.5. This is your thermal, and dt by dl you have to calculate, right? So from here, if you calculate, this will come out to be dt by dl out to be 60 into 10 raised to the power minus 3 divided by 2.5, right? But this is coming out to be in degree Celsius per meter, right? But the answer is asking it in kilometers. So if you convert meter into kilometer, if I write it kilometer, I have to multiply it with 1000, because this 1000 will go up. So this gets cancelled, and 60 upon 2.5 is 24. So this is 24 degrees Celsius per kilometer. You have to take care of the units, right? Otherwise the answer will come in 0.024, which is not right, because it is asking you in degrees Celsius per kilometer, and everything here is given in meters. So make sure you convert meter back to kilometers and you get 24 degrees Celsius per kilometer. So this is fairly easy question. You have to take care of the unit though. Now this is the grade of copper question. In this it says the ore body determined at three locations, 1, 2 and 3, as you can see in the figure, this one, this and this. The grade of copper to be known at location X. At some location X, you have to find the grade of copper using the inverse square distance weighting. So inverse square distance weighting is a simple expression to, you know, quantify data points which are spread across the region. So IDW, inverse distance weighting, is a simple mathematical expression, right, that is equal to sigma. Let's say I'm talking about grade of copper, so this is the G value, GI grade, divided by XI square. This XI is the distance from fixed point. You have to add all those, divided by 1 upon XI square. You have to add this up, right? The expression, I'll tell you, expression becomes 1.5. If we talk about this grade here, this is 1.5 divided by 2 meters, so 2 squared, because it is inverse is square distance, right? Plus this will be 2.5 divided by 5 squared plus 1.8 divided by 3 squared and divided by 1 upon 2 square plus 1 upon 5 square plus 1 upon 3 square. You have to solve this expression. So if you solve this expression, you will get the grade value of equal to 1.68%, and that is the answer here. It is 1.68. that is the just what you had to calculate in this expression. So this is kind of an weighted average kind of a thing, right? But it is inverse the square, because the farther you go, the less the value becomes. The most, next question, the most coleferous unit of Gondwana supergroup is Badakar. You all know this, right? This is a fairly straightforward question. Then you have this, the water table in an unconfined aquifer is placed near the coast, at a place near the coast is 1 meter above the mean. See, this question is easy. What you do, you see, let's say this is your mean sea level, right? And here is your water table like this, right? So this is your mean sea level. I can say, call it MSL. And this is, let's say, your water table. It says the water table is 1 meter above the mean sea level. So let's say this is my water table, right? So this distance is 1 meter. Right now it is saying, so let's say this is the interface, let's say this is the interface between what, seawater and let's say fresh water, right? So if I take the position where it is 1 meter above, let's say it is 1 meter above here, so below, if I go below at this point, the pressure should be same. The pressure should be same. So at this point, the pressure, let's say this height is H, right? And this height becomes h again, and this is 1. So this whole thing is fresh water and this is your seawater. Now it is saying take the density of fresh water as 1.001 and density of seawater as 1.025. Okay, 1.025, which is normal saline water density. Now it is asking you ki what should be the depth at the contact. This the contact between this fresh water and the seawater should be at what depth, right? So first you need to calculate h value. How you can calculate h value is at the interface the pressure will be same, right? That's why, because they are at interface, that means they are not moving in any direction. So this at this point the pressure will be same. So we can do h rho g at this point for seawater and fresh water should be equal. So if I write it for seawater, h, the value of h, rho is 1.025 and g, let's say I take it 10. If you write it g also is no problem because it will get cancelled out. If I write it fresh water here, for fresh water the height is h plus 1, right? This h and this 1 plus there will be a density of 1.001 into g, plus nahi, this is into n into g. So this g gets cancelled, right? From here if you solve it you get h 1.025 minus 1.001 equal to 1.001. So if you solve it further, h comes out to be 1.001 divided by, this will be 0.024, right? So if you solve this you will get a distance of 41.7 meters. So value of h in this question comes out to be 41.7. Now the question is not over because it is not asking you the distance of h. If you read the question clearly, it is not asking you that. What it is asking is, I'm just, you know, recalculating it to see whether it is correct. Yeah, it is 41.7 meters. What it is asking is the depth from the water table. Now this is the water table and your h is 41.7. So the distance from water table, you have to add this one also, because the whole depth will be 41.7 plus 1. So answer here will be 42.7. This is a little, you know, you have to be very careful about it. So if you round it off also, it will come out to be 41.702 something. So this will be 42.7 meters from the water table. Be very careful, it is asking you from the water table. Okay, next question. It says a stratified aquifer consists of a 3 parallel homogeneous and isotropic layers with thickness 10 meters, 5 meters and 5 meters. So I can make this something like this, right? In which there are 3 layers of aquifers, parallel layers. In this, this is the thickest one with 10 meter thickness and these two are 5 meters. Right, so this thickness is 10, this thickness is 5 and this thickness is 5. So it is asking you to find the equivalent hydraulic conductivity. What is given? The hydraulic conductivity of each of this layer is given. This is 15 meters per day, this is 20 meters per day and this is 30 meters per day, right? So you have to find what will be the equivalent. If you replace all this by a layer that has equivalent k, same thing will happen. Okay, same amount of water will get discharged. So considering the same hydraulic conductivity, same hydraulic gradient, means the hydraulic gradient from this side to this side is same for all these three layers, right? 1, 2 and 3. In one of my videos, I have told you how to calculate K equivalent. You can find it here. Now, I'll directly give you the expression here. K equivalent is you add sigma all the layers thickness, which is let's say B value. Thickness is given in B mostly, and K value. So Ki Bi. That means the product of hydraulic conductivity into the thickness divided by sum of all those thickness Bi. So if I apply this formula here, this becomes 10 into 15 plus 20 into 5 plus 30 into 5 again, because this thickness divided by total thickness is 10 plus 5 plus 5. So if you solve this here, the above expression becomes 150 plus 150, 400 divided by 20, right? So here it comes out to be 20 meters per day. This is the equivalent hydraulic conductivity. So this is 20. Okay, you can see the video where I have derived this all value of this K current. There can also be perpendicular layers like this, right, in which water is flowing downwards. So that can also be asked. Next question. Furangian is an epoch of. Well, this question is very factual, and Gate never asked this, means it doesn't go beyond period and at the epoch level, but the question is there. So the answer here is Cambrian. Why Furangian? Because at the start of Furangian, this is the or you can say the lower boundary of Furangian is marked by first appearance of trilobite. First appearance datum FAD of trilobite is starting here, and this boundary again is the first appearance datum of conodonts. These are also microfossils. So conodonts and trilobite is at the lower boundary, and that's why maybe they have asked this is the importance of Furangian. Trilobite is a index fossil of this Cambrian period, so, or you can say Silurian Ordovician epoch. So that's why. Okay, but it has not gone to this level of details of geological time scale, but nevertheless the question is here. So yeah, this question: a mantle source rock melts at a time T naught, giving rise to a melt M and residue R. Okay, so what is this? Let's say this is your mantle rock, right? Now in this mantle rock, you are melting this mantle rock. So when you are melting this mantle rock, it will convert into a melt and will convert to a, means the left behind is the residue. Now see, it is asking you about the evolution of ND isotope and the SR isotope. Now you know, if you know, RB SR is a systematic in which RB converts into SR and SMND. Samarium converts into neodymium. Now in RBSR system, RB is a big molecule, right? Or you can say not molecule, big size atom. So this is incompatible, right? And SMND, ND is incompatible. So if you know this question can, so this is the thing that you should know, that which one of this is incompatible, right? So when you melt this mantle reservoir or mantle source rock, which atom will prefer to go into the melt? So whatever the incompatible elements or incompatible atoms, they prefer to stay in liquid, right? So in the melt that you are forming, that will be having higher proportions of RB and higher proportions of neodymium, right? And in residue, you will have high proportions of SR and high proportions of SM. Now the question is asking, what will be the growth of these two daughter isotope or daughter, you can say the daughter of daughter nucleus, right? Because these are isotopic decay, radioactive decay. So here you see, if Rb is more here, that means the growth of Sr in the melt, or this melt is forming a rock which is M, right? Solidifying and forming M, and residue is R. So this M in this rock, M that crystallized to form a rock, this melt, will have more Rb. More Rb means the rate of formation of Sr will be more here, because you see, radioactive decay is a first order decay, right? And you know, the rate of first order decay is directly proportional to the concentration of the reactant. Whatever is the reactant, it is dependent on that. If there is more Rb, the rate of formation of Sr will be more. So in the melt, the rate of formation of Sr will be more, and the residue, because this is the parent will only convert into daughter, right? So Sm will convert into Nd. So the formation of rate of Nd will be more in residue, and formation of Sr rate will be more in melt. So now we can go to the options. The growth of Nd and Sr isotope ratio in M and R would depend on the initial concentration of Sm and Mb in the mantle source rock. No, it doesn't really depend on the initial concentration of Sm and Rb. It actually depends on the proportion in which they are going into the melt and the residue. Okay, so this is wrong. The growth of Nd isotope ratio versus time is faster in R. So in R, Nd will grow more. Yes, this is correct, because more parent is here, right? Sm is more in residue, so growth with time will be more of Nd in the residue. So this statement is correct, right? Faster than M. In M, because M, in M there is no Sm or very less Sm, so the growth will be less, more will be in the residue. So this is when current, and Sr isotope ratio grows slower in R than M. Yes, because it will grow faster in the melt, not in the residue, because more Rb is here. More Rb will convert into more Sr, so the growth will be more in the melt. So this is also correct, is slower in R than M. So second option will be right here. Okay, you can check the other two options. This is absolutely wrong. They cannot grow with the identical rates, right? Because different concentrations. So you need to know this first order kinetics. The rate is directly proportional to the amount of parent nuclei or the reactant in the system. So more parent jisme bhi hoga. If it is more in the melt, it will grow faster. If it is more in the residue, it will grow faster. And where it will be more, you can decide that by incompatibility ratio. So the incompatible one will be more in the melt. Okay, so yeah, next question. With regard to superforce folding, the stereographic position represents a geometry of. Now in this, you see, it is showing you a axial plane which is going through the center. That means axial plane is vertical, right? And this is F1, it is dipping. F, these are fold axes, right? So imagine a fold like this. Right? So in this fold, this is your cylindrical axis, or you can say fold axis, and this is your fold axis. The fold is obviously non-cylindrical, because if it is cylindrical, then it has one direction of fold axis, but here there are two, that means it is no longer cylindrical, right? So this option is wrong, right? And now this is your axial plane here, like this, or first order axial plane or second order, both of them are, if you say this fold here, the axial plane will be like this, but both are vertical, right? So if you talk about the first axial plane, AP1, it is still vertical. Even if you bend this fold, the axial plane remains vertical. So it is plane non-cylindrical fold, Option will be one, plane. What is planar? It has not folded with respect to the axial plane and it is non-cylindrical. So first option. Low value of SP log as observed in the dispersed shale is mainly due to the impeded movement of what? See, jo shale hota hai na, it has clay minerals and clay mineral has a tendency to have surface charge distribution. So the surface charge, negative surface charge comes on the surface of the shale, right? And it attracts the Na plus, because in a shale rock there are all this ions Na, K plus, OH, but mostly it is NaCl. But Cl minus is negative, right? And the mobility of Cl minus is more than Na plus, but because of this negative charge there is a repulsion and it is not attracted towards it, right? While Na is gets attracted. So it is the impeded movement of Cl minus that is giving you the less value of SP log. So it is Cl minus here. See, SP log mein hota kya hai ki there is this Na plus and there is this Cl minus, right? The when water is bipolar, right? So when water surrounds this molecule, the size of Na actually becomes greater than the size of Cl minus when it is surrounded by water molecule. So the mobility of Cl minus is more than Na plus. So Cl minus comes to this side of the lower concentration. Let's say the concentration here of NaCl is high, here it is low. So it will move towards the lower concentration, right? And there is a charge separation. There is minus, 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 negative charge on this side and a positive charge on this side. So you see there is a potential that is developed between these two, right? That is called as self potential, SP, right? And because of that there will be some current that will be observed in this direction, right? So electrons will, in whatever direction electrons move, you will have a potential difference. Now because of this this clay, this movement of Cl minus is restricted. And that is what it is asked in the question. Impeded movement is of Cl minus. Okay, so next question. Which of the given planet has the highest average density? Well, this is a factual question. Earth has the highest density of 5.5. Value of this is 5.5 gram per cc. This is the average density of Earth. And this is very high, or this is highest in terms of all terrestrial planet, because it has a very big solid iron core. The iron core is also present in other planet, but it's not very big, right? This is the thing that is giving Earth its increasing its average density. Okay, the core of the Earth. Okay, 20th. This question is a Mazda column, right, from the ore chapter. Here the answer is this Bawla Nawshi deposits. This is from the PGM resource. So P4. So these two are wrong. P4 and Amba Dongar Ingria complex, this is from the RE mineralization. So P4, Q1, R2 and S3. So answer here will be 1. Right? Sargipalli PBZN, this is from the residual concentration. Okay. Gangpur group. East Coast Bauxite is from the residual concentration. So this is the answer. P4, Q1, R2 and S3. Okay. The symmetry elements of a point group are 3 crystallographic axes of 2-fold symmetry. So there are 3 crystallographic, all the, so these are perpendicular. Crystallographic axes mean they are perpendicular to each other. So this is A, this is B and this is C. So there is a 2-fold axis, right, along all these 3. So they are mutually perpendicular. And it says there is 3 mirror planes perpendicular to crystallographic axis also. So there is a mirror plane here going through, and there is a mirror plane here, and there is a mirror plane here also, right? So in HN symbols, when the mirror plane is perpendicular to the axis, you write it as 2/m. And because all these 3 axes here are unique, the symbol will be 2/m, 2/m, 2/m. and this is actually from the orthorhombic group. Okay, so 2 by m, 2 by m, 2 by m, because it is not single 2 by m, because you cannot reproduce this axis. All these twofold axes are unique, right? So you have to include all of them in the symbol. So it will be 2 by m, 2 by m, 2 by m. This is an interesting question. A satellite orbits around the Earth at an altitude of 700 kilometers on the equatorial plane of the Earth. So if I make the figure, let's say this is Earth, right? And this is the satellite movement. So this is the satellite. So this distance, right? This distance is 6300 plus 700 kilometers, which is, I can call it 7000 kilometers. 7000 kilometers. So this Earth and this satellite will have a force of gravitation acting between them. So I can write that also. Force will be equal to G, mass of Earth, mass of satellite, divided by this 7000 into 10 raised to the power 3 squared. I am converting it into meters. Now this whole force, this is the force that will be, you know, giving satellite its tangential velocity, right? So this should be equal to mass of satellite into V square by R. MV square by R is the centrifugal force or centripetal force, and R here again will be same, 7000 into 10 raised to power 3 MV square by R. So in this expression, there is, if we cancel it, MS get, mass of satellite will not come in the expression, but we don't know this value of G and mass of Earth. For that, we know this, that GM by R square, GME by R square is equal to 10. This is acceleration due to gravity. They have asked to take it as 10 meter per, it is actually 9.8, but you can, as given in the question, you have to take it 10 meters per second square. That is fine. So instead of, now this R here is the radius of Earth, right? So value of, instead of GME, I can write 6300 into 10 raised to the power 3 squared into 10. This is the expression for, instead of GME. So I'll put the value of GME from here in this equation. So I get 6300 into 10 raised to the power 3 squared and this gets cancelled, so divided by 7000 into 10 raised to the power 3 is equal to V square, right? So if you calculate V from here, this will be, V will be equal to 6300 into 10 raised to power 3 divided by, if I take 10 raised to power 3 here into under root 7, yeah, and there will be one component of G also here, right? This 10, so into under root 10. So you have to solve this equation now. For here, if you solve it, it will come out to be 7530. Yeah, if you solve this, you will get 75. I have solved it before. Yeah, so it will be 7530 meters per second. But again, you see, they have not asked you the answer in meters per second. They have asked you the answer in kilometers per second. So if you divide it by 1000, you will get 7.530 kilometers per second. So 7.530. Okay. So this will be the answer for this question. Next question. Which of the following phases is P wave that converts into S wave? So whenever the wave converts into S waves while passing through the solid inner core, the expression that is used is J, right? So first it started as a P wave, entered the core, so P K, then enter the inner core as S wave, so this is J. So answer here will be P K J K P. Which of the following structures indicate thin sedimentary deformation? So convolute bedding, because this it is getting deposited, or this is getting formed during the deposition itself, right? So it's like this, it flows like this, convolute bedding, because it is still it is forming is during the deposition. It's convolute bedding. The radiometric survey, the gamma ray spectrometer, counter rate depends on. Counter rate depends on the solid angle. Means whatever is the surface you are looking at, the angle that it is projecting, right, on the detector, which is, let's say, on an aircraft, right. So the detector response, right, is modeled by calculating variation in solid angle, right, and that affects the counter rate. So here the answer will be solid angle of the target rock about the spectrometer, which is counting the gamma rays. So more the solid angle, more, and also depends on the topography. Here the same solid angle will give you more number of rocks, here less, this is a planar area. So solid angle plays a role in the count rate. Properties of soil, it says the mass and volume of a fully dried sample. Mass and volume, so volume, total volume of the soil is given to be 1100 cc. okay, now if it is fully dried, the weight will be actually the weight of the solid particle or the soil particles, 2200, because it is dried. Okay, so this dried sample is 2200 gram, that means this is the weight of the solid particles. Now it is saying specific gravity of the soil particle is 2.5. now specific gravity, as we know, is density of the substance divided by density of water. Now in gram per cc, density of water will be 1. So if it is 2.5, the density of the soil particles will be nothing but 2.5 only, 2.5 cc, gram per cc. So 2.5 gram per cc is the density of, from specific gravity we calculated this. It is water density is 1 gram per cc. It is asking the void ratio. Now so void ratio is given by volume of voids divided by volume of soil particles. So it's not total volume, that will be porosity. So volume of voids. So if you see in a soil, what is the total volume? Total volume will be volume of soil particles plus the volume of voids. This will comprise the total volume of the soil. Now you have to calculate this. You know the total volume, it is given in the question. You need to calculate the volume of soil particles. So if you know the density and the mass, you know density is mass per unit volume, right? So if you calculate volume of soil particles, it will be mass of soil particle, which is 2200 divided by 2.5. this is the volume of soil particles, right? So if you solve this, you will get volume of soil particles. Let me do it. So void ratio becomes, instead of VV, I can write total volume minus the volume of soil particles. So it is 1100 minus 2200 divided by 2.5 divided by volume of soil particles, which is 2200 divided by 2.5. If you solve this expression, you will get void ratio as 1/4 or 0.25. So in this case, the void ratio of the soil is 0.25. Next question. A rock formed at time t equal to 0 with number of 14 C carbon atom at 10^5. So your initial value of N naught is 10^5. Okay, the number of 14 carbon atoms in log 10 after time 8 × 10^3. So time is given 8 × 10^3. Okay, decay constant is also given in the question, which is 1.25 × 10^-4 year inverse. Now the expression for first order, or you can say radioactive decay, is number of or you say carbon atoms at any time t will be equal to n naught. I'm not deriving this expression, but it is this minus lambda t. All of you know this. Nt is equal to n naught e to the power minus lambda t. Before putting it here, let me calculate the value of lambda t here. Right, lambda t is equal to 1.25 into 10 to the power minus 4 into 8 into 10 to the power 3, or 8,000 years. Right. So 8 into 1.25 is 10. Into 10 raised to the power minus 1. So this comes out to be 1. The value of lambda t is 1. Right. So nt becomes n naught, which is 10 raised to the power 5 into e to the power minus 1. Now it is asking you the answer in log 10 terms. So if you take a log here, log of nt, this becomes log of 10 raised to the power 5. I'm sorry, into log of e raised to the power minus 1. The log of 10 raised to the power 5 is 5. This will be plus this minus 1 will come outside, so it will be minus 1 log of e. So if you calculate this expression, it will come out to be 4.566. So the value of log n at any after time t will be 4.566. So you can write it 4.566. Okay. So this is the calculation for this question. The volume percentage of galena in quartz in ore body is in the ratio of 90 and 10 respectively. This is volume percentage. Okay. And the density of the galena and quartz is given. The grade of the ore body in terms of weight percent you have to calculate. Okay. So how to go about it? Let's say we take 100 ml of that body. Ore body. Okay, if I take 100 ml or 100 cc, my volume percentage is 90 to 10. That means in that 90 ml, in that 100 ml, 90 ml will be galena and 10 ml will be my quartz. And galena, you know, is PbS, right? Lead sulfide. Now density is given, so from here I can calculate the what will be the weight in that 100 ml. What will be the weight of galena? I can write weight of galena here will be, so mass will be volume into density, so it will be 90 into 7.6. it is in gram per cc, so no problem. Cc and milliliter is same, so 90 into 7.6, if you calculate, you will get 684 grams. Right, 684 grams. And from here also I can calculate the weight of quartz, so it is 10 into 2.65, so it will be 26.5 grams. This is the weight, total weight of 100 ml. If you take 100 ml of this ore body, its weight will be equal to 684 plus 26.5. now out of this 684 grams of galena, how much is PB? So now you have to calculate how much PB is present in galena. So let's say weight percent of PB. So PB in galena is 206. This is the weight, or you can say atomic weight, 206 divided by 238. This is the total molecular weight of PbS in 200. This will be the percentage of PB that is present in the gallon. So if you calculate this, this will come out to be 86.55%. So 86.55% of this will be the amount of gallon which is present. Yes or no? But it is asking you the grade, right? Grade of the ore body. So the total weight here, in this case, the total weight of this ore body is 684 plus 26.5, which is 710.5. Now try to understand, this is the total weight of the ore body and this is the weight of galena. So this is the weight percent of, not volume percent. Okay, it is asking the question in terms of weight percent. So this is the weight percent of galena, and in that galena you have 0.8655% of lead, right? Because it is asking the percent of lead. So 684 upon 710 into 0.8655, this expression will give you the value of PB. So if you calculate this, you will get 0.8333. But it is again asking in terms of percentage, so you multiply it with 100, so you get 83.33. so here the answer will be, the grade will be 83.33%, which is a very high grade. Under uniaxial compression, a cylindrical quartzite specimen showed a linear elastic behavior. So when there is a linear elastic behavior, we can use Young's modulus, right? The uniaxial compressive strength and the modulus ratio. So modulus ratio is given by Young's modulus at 50% value of the total, you know, compressive strength, divided by the value of compressive strength, sigma t. Sigma c compressive strength. So if you calculate this, MR is given to be 500, modulus ratio ET 50, you have to calculate, divided by 150 megapascal, right? So if you calculate it, your E comes out to be 00075 megapascal. So this is 75,000 megapascals. Now from the expression of Hooke's law, we know stress is directly proportional to strain. So the axial strain is 75 at 75 megapascal. So 75 megapascal is your stress. So 75 megapascal is the stress which is directly proportional to the strain. You have to calculate this strain, let's say strain, and Young's modulus will come here, right? Well, stress upon strain is Young's modulus. So now you just have to put the value. Your strain will be 75 divided by Young's modulus, 75,000. Both are in megapascal, so no problem, it is 1/1000. Strain is 1/1000, but it is not asking you strain, it is asking you millistrain. So to calculate millistrain, you have to divide this with 1000. So your milli, I can write it like milli strain upon 1000, right? This will be your strain, can be written as milli strain upon 1000 is 1/1000, right? This expression, so 1000 gets cancelled, your milli strain value comes out to be 1. So it is 1 milli strain, right? So answer will be 1. Okay, so converting strain into millistrain, you multiply with 1000. Strain yahan se aap aise bhi nikal sakte, strain will come out to be 0.001, right? To convert into millistrain, if you come converting into some smaller value, your value, the actual value, numerical value, or your magnitude will increase. So you multiply it with 1000, you get 1, right? 33, this question, see, radon is an atom of iron, right? And cesium is a lithophile. So P4, cadmium, AU is a siderophile. So Q1, and CD is a chalcopyrrol. So this is the expression. So it is P4Q1. So P4Q1, 4 is the right answer, R2 and S3. Okay. This Goldsmith's classification of elements, if you want to read it, you can read it at Goldsmith's classification of elements, in which it has classified element based on these properties. Siderophile is iron loving, right? Chalcophile is copper, atmophile the one which goes in the atmosphere, and lithophile is rock loving elements. So they distribute themselves over this this type of, you know, relative abundance. Okay, the given outcrop pattern of the bed shaded in gray with respect to the contour and dashed line indicates that the bed, see, if the bed is this, right, its nose is in the valley. If the nose is upward, then obviously it is dipping upstream, so it's not horizontal. Of course it is not horizontal. It is not dipping downstream, because if it is dipping downstream, the bed would be like this, right? So it is not dipping downstream. So dip downstream is wrong. So the correct answer here is dips upstream. An aqueous polyphase L plus V plus solid inclusion contains a halide daughter crystal at room temperature and pressure. Which of the given statements is correct? The salinity of the bulk aqueous fluid can be determined from the temperature of melting ice. This is wrong, because you still have solid in the system, right? You can calculate salinity when the solid get completely melt into the liquid or completely dissolved into the liquid, right? So this is wrong. Density in all cases can be determined from the temperature of liquid vapor homogenization. No, you can determine the salinity. The salinity of the bulk aqueous fluid can be determined from the temperature of the dissolution of halide. Yeah, as you keep on increasing the temperature, this solid will slowly, or this halide crystal will slowly get dissolved in liquid. And at the point when it just the last solid particle get dissolved in liquid, at that point you can calculate the salinity. So 3 is correct. Right, density can be calculated from the complete homogenization, right? But for that you have to melt the solid also. It's not liquid vapor, right? The solid should also be completely melted into the liquid, and then it has to convert into one single phase. Then from the PT diagram, I have done a video on that also, you can find it. So next question. Match the following invertebrate genera in group 1 with their corresponding class or phylum. This is very easy, right? In this case, the answer will be P. Mytilus is a Pelecypoda. Then you have Planorbis, which is Gastropoda. Productus, which is Brachiopoda. And Acanthoceras, which is your cephalopod. So this is P4, Q3, R1 and S2. A surface geological process that can create landform called surf is glacial erosion. Glacial erosion forms surfs in the mountains, which is a cup-like shape or a bowl-like shape like this, right? This in this there is a surf glacier also in the glacial season. Otherwise it is, you know, filled with water. There are lakes that are found in surfs. They're called Tarn Lake. Anyways, if you move forward, you have 39. The based on the three statements given below, choose the correct option. Gundredahi formation is a stratigraphic unit of Chhattisgarh. This is correct. Ranjinganj formation of coal bearing trisic unit. Is a coal bearing trisic unit? No, it is not trisic. Ranjinganj is Permian. Right, and Permian, what is in Permian? So this statement is wrong. Pipteni volcanic is a stratigraphic unit of Donangarh supergroup. This is correct. So second is wrong. First and third are correct. So the fourth will be correct. Statement one and third are correct, but statement two is incorrect. The dimensions of radiance emittance of a black body. Emittance is watt per meter square. Right. So to calculate the dimension, you can break up this watt. Watt is what? It is energy per unit time. So I can write it joules per second. Joules per second. And this is meter square. Now what is joules? Joules is form of energy. Energy per unit time is what? Which is power. Joules. Joules is expression of energy. Energy is Newton meter. So instead of, now I'm breaking it down, I can write it Newton into meter divided by second into 1 upon meter square. Now if I go further, what is Newton? Newton is force. Force is mass into acceleration. So mass is kg and acceleration is meter per second square into, there was meter, there is second, and there is 1 upon meter. Now this is the basic SI units. Now you cannot further break it down, right? So you see, this is meter and meter, this is meter square, so it gets cancelled, right? So there is no expression of length here. This is boils down to kg per second cube. Now kg is m, so m is 1. There is no length unit, so l will be 0. And t is in denominator, so it will be t minus 3 time. So m1 l0 t minus 3, which is first. This is the correct dimension of emittance, right? If it is emittance, means per meter square. This is the thing that you should know to solve this question. It is power per unit area, right? Which of the following equid genera was one toed grazer? So this is Pliohippus, which was the first one-toed grazer. These all have toes which is more than one. Right? Started from 5, 3, and then finally you have Pliohippus, which has only one toe. This is horse. This is evolution of horse. Normal move out for reflected phase in seismic data is 2 milliseconds. Consider the diffraction source at the edge of the same reflector where short point is directly above the diffraction source. So it's something like this. So this is your short point and this is your point where diffraction is happening. So the normal move out normally will be like this. It goes like this, right? If we take this as d, right, this distance as d and this as x, right? So when a wave is traveling in this path, goes like this and reaches here, let's say it takes time t r, it is a reflected wave, right? And when it goes directly down and comes back, it takes time t naught. So this t r minus t naught, this is the normal move out, right, for a reflector. But for a diffractor, when the diffract source, see, diffraction source is directly below the short point. That means it is somewhere here, right? At this, like this. So when the seismic phase is coming down, directly down, and it is getting diffracted, it will diffract it in all the directions, like a new source, and it, one of the phase will go like this, and it will reach here. So this will also take some time. Let's say TD, right? So the normal move out for this diffraction will be TD minus T naught, right? Now you can calculate this value because you know this distance and this. If you calculate this, this actually comes out to be twice of this, TR minus T naught. I'm telling you this because the derivation is very long, but if you do this, it will come out to be equal to twice of this value of normal move out of the reflector. So this is given to be 2 milliseconds. So 2 into 2 is 4. So answer here will be 4 milliseconds. It is double of reflected normal move out. Okay. Taillite is faceted boulders and green shale with dropstone characterizes the lithology of its Talcher. Talcher was the for Talcher formation shows the expressions of glacier movement in it. So this tillite is a glacial deposition, dropstone is also from the glacier. So yeah. Now 45, taphonomy. Which statement is correct? So taphonomy refers to the study of fossilization pathway from death of an organism to its recovery as fossil. This is correct. Not to burial. The death of an organism to its burial is actually biostratinomy. Okay, from death to burial, it is biostratinomy. Then after that, or we can say necrolysis. Necrolysis means when an organism dies. And after that, diagenesis starts. Means whatever happens after it gets buried. This whole thing till it gets recovered is called taphonomy. So with regard to the occurrence of groundwater in this question, with regard to the occurrence of groundwater, which of the following statement is correct? Vedos water occurs in the zone of saturation. This is wrong. It occurs in the zone of insaturation or unsaturation. The depth of purged water table is less than that of the water table. This is correct. Because if this is your purged water table, the water table is always below it. So depth is less for the purged water table. Other two expressions will also be wrong. Let's check. The zone of aeration lies below. No, it lies above the zone of saturation. And the water table marks the uppermost surface. No. Uppermost surface of the Vedas zone. No. Water table marks the uppermost surface of the groundwater, not the Vedas zone. So yeah. Which of the following structures in group 1 with corresponding environment of deposition? This is very easy. Star dune is aeolian. Lateral moraine is glacial. Lateral accretionary surface is fluvial. And herringbone cross stratification is from tidal. So it is P4Q1R2. This is second is the correct. 47D. Now in 2D seismic surface, first receiver location is 1000 meter and 4000 meter. Okay, so for this you can easily make a Cartesian coordinate system and you can do this. So this is 1000, let's say this is 1000, 2000, 3000, 4000 and 1000, 2000, 3000 like this, right? So 1000 and 4000, 1, 2, 3, 4, this is the point. And second receiver location is 2000, 4000, which is 2 and 4, so somewhere here. And your source location is 2000, 1000, so 2000, 1000, which is this point. 2 and 1, so yeah, here. Right. So it is asking difference in the first arrival time of P wave phase. So this distance, the receiver will, the source will send P wave in this direction and in this direction. So it will take some time. You have to calculate the difference in this time. Right. This can be easily done. Aise dekho. This is 4. Let me write it. This is 2000. 4000. This is obviously 1000. 4000. And this is 2000, 1000. So these two are lying in the same line. So this distance you can easily see, this is 3000 meters. This you can calculate using the distance formula, or you can also do it because this distance is 1000. This is 1000 meters. Maybe this is 1000. So 1000 and 3000, you can calculate this with Pythagoras equation. And now your time difference, or you can say the difference in first arrival. So first, this will take more time because it has to travel more distance. So this will be time is distance upon speed. So distance. So if you calculate distance, this is 3000 squared plus 1000 squared root. So it is 10 raised to the power 3 under root 10. This will be the distance divided by the speed of P wave is taken to be 5000 meters per second. So this is the time it will take to reach here minus the time it will take from here till the second source or second receiver, which is just 3000. So 3000 divided by 5000. This is the delta t they are asking in the question, right? But this is, it will come in seconds because my velocity is in meters per second. If you solve this, you will get 0.03244. So it is asking at two decimal places, so 0.03 will be the correct answer. 49, in zone of active normal faulting, the maximum and minimum in situ principal stress is 30 and 10 megapascals respectively. The fault plane striking north south has a dip amount of 60 degree towards east. Okay, so this is your fault plane, let's say this is your east, right? This is giving you this angle as 60 degrees, right? This is your sigma 1, right? 30 megapascal. And this is your sigma 3, which is 10 megapascals. So obviously this angle will be 30 degrees, Anderson theory. It will make 30 degree with sigma 1. So now you can do it easily with the Mohr circle also, because if you take, let's say this is your Mohr circle, this value is 30 megapascal, this value is 10, right? Now it is making 60 degrees. If you can see, this is also making 60 degrees with the sigma 3. So you can, this fault plane, you can mark this fault plane on the Mohr circle. It will be like this. Two ways you can do it. It is making 120 degrees with 2 theta, right? It is making 60 degree with sigma 3. So from here it will be 120 degrees, or you can directly take 60 degrees from here. It is same thing. So this is 60 degrees, right? Now this is the Mohr circle. Its radius will be 10 megapascals. If you can see, this is 10, this is 30. So this whole length is 20. So the radius will be 10. Now at this plane, they are asking what will be the normal stress on the fault plane. So if I drop a line here, this point, so this length will be your normal stress, right? So this is 10, this angle is 60 degrees. That means this is your 5, 10 cos 60, this length is 5, right? So this is 10, this whole radius is 10, this is 5, so this is 5. So from here, this is 10 and this is 5. So total normal stress will be 10 plus 5, which is 15 megapascal. So 15 megapascal is the normal stress that is acting on the fault plane. You can do it for Mohr circle. 50, this says the drainage basin of fourth order, there are four orders, has an area of 35 kilometer square. So the area of my basin is 35 kilometer squared. Within the basin, the length of the first order, second and third order is given 11.5, 8.5 and 4.2. Drainage density, now drainage density is 0.8. Now drainage density is what? Total length of the all the orders of rivers, total length of the channel divided by the area. So total length will be 11.5 plus 8.5 plus 4.2 plus the fourth order, we don't know that, divided by the area, 35 kilometer square. Right, this length is also in kilometers, so no issues. If you solve it, you will get fourth ka answer will be 3.8. If you solve it, you get 3.8 kilometers. You just have to simply solve it. Add this up and 35 into 0.8. Solve this, you'll get 3.8 kilometers. So it is 3.8. This is round off to one decimal, 3.8 kilometers. Easy question, directly based on formula. The circular tunnel is being excavated by a blocky rock mass by drilling and blasting. So this is the circular tunnel, and this is the excavated disturbed zone, which is your EDZ, right? Tunnel extends to 0.7 meter. So this length is given to be 0.7 meters, right? And in the rock form of, to form the excavation surface. from the excavation survey. So this is 0.7. Considering the unit weight of the rock as 25 kilonewton per meter cube. For per meter cube, the weight is 25 kilonewtons. Right? The support pressure required to crown the at the crown of the tunnel to stabilize the loose block. So the loose block of EDZ, you have to stabilize it. So this is the pressure per meter cube, kilonewton. This is the force. The weight of the rock is kilonewton per meter cube. So if I take a 1 meter square area here like this, right, this block like this, the volume of this block here will be 1 into 1 into this is 0.75. so this will come out to be 0.7, not 75, it is 0.7, so it will be 0.7 meter cube. So per meter cube is 25 kilonewton. So for per meter cube, the unit weight will be, or the weight, not unit, the weight will be 25 into 0.7, right? So if you calculate this 25 into 0.7, you will get 17.5 kilonewton, right? This is the total weight. Now it is acting. Now you have to calculate the weight per unit area. So area I have taken 1 meter square, right? So my weight will also be, or my pressure, or you can say the support pressure that I will be required to provide from below will be the weight that is experienced in this 1 meter square area, which is again 17.5. So 17.5 kilonewton per meter square. This is the weight I'll feel. Now newton per meter square is pascals, so it is 17.5 kilopascals. It is asking in kilopascals only, so answer will be 17.5. There are indication of presence of massive tabular multimeter sulfide ore body at the shallow depth of the surface. Which of the following would be the most efficient? So sulfide ore has the ability to produce a self potential, so we can use this first method by to locate and confirm the presence of this ore body, self potential method, in which you deploy a primary magnetic field, right, and the self potential also develops its own magnetic field. You can see, you can also do it with the electromagnetic method, EM method also, but here the best way to go about is self potential, because sulfide ore produces this potential difference within it, within itself, because of the oxidation that is going on. So that helps in finding out the location, the size and everything of the ore body. Now, constant head perimeter test was performed on a vertical section of the column of height 40 centimeter. So your sand column has a height of 40 centimeters. Okay, so this is 40. And cross sectional area here is 25 centimeters square. Sorry, right? 25 centimeters square. Okay, during the test, when the loss of the head was 50 centimeters, so head loss is 50 centimeters, and the volume that was collected was for 2 minutes was 300 centimeter cube. So 300 centimeter cube was collected for 2 minutes. So if I ask, if I try to find out what is the volume per second, that is my discharge, right? So it is 300 centimeter cube divided by 2 minutes, which is 120 seconds. This is volume per second, right? And if I divide it by area, right, I'll get the velocity, right? So my Darcy velocity, right, VD, my Darcy velocity will be 300 divided by 120 and divided by area, which is 25, right? Everything is in centimeters, so no issues. Now this should be equal to hydraulic conductivity K into the head gradient, right? So this gradient is 50 centimeters divided by 40. Hydraulic gradient. 50 is the head loss and 40 is the length through which the water is flowing through this sand column. So to solve this, from here you will find out the K value, which is equal to 0.08 centimeters per second. We just have to solve this. Okay, I can solve it here also. Okay, this is 3, 4, 12, 100. This is 1. So K comes out to be 100 or 500 by 4. This comes out to be, your K will be equal to 4 upon 500. So if you solve this, it is 0.08 centimeters per second. So 0.08. Okay. The potential difference measured between two electrodes using Wenner array is 500 millivolt. So for Wenner array, the resistivity formula is rho is equal to 2 pi A V by I. Right, so we have to calculate distance between the current electrodes. Okay, so my rho is given to be 100 ohm meter. So this is 100 ohm meter. Okay, 2 pi 2 into 3.141 into A. I have to calculate this into my V is 500 millivolts, so I can write it 500 into 10 raised to the power minus 3. This is in SI unit, divided by current, which is 2 amperes. So if I solve this, let's see, 500 into 2 is 1000, and this is 10 to the power minus 3, so this is 1. So from here, if I calculate A, it will be 200 divided by 3.141. Right, this if I calculate comes out to be 63.66. Now most of you will write this answer, but the thing is, it is not asking you the distance between the potential electrodes. If you know Wenner diagram, right, this is your potential electrodes and this is your current electrode, which you write normally as AB, and this normally is MNN. Right, this is your potential electrode, voltmeter, and here is your amperes. So current electrode, this is A and A in Wenner array, A and A, this distance. So it is actually asking you the value of 3A, not just A. So current electrode per distance will be 3A, which is 3, 6, 18, 8, 9, 3, 3 is 9, 10. 190.98. So round up to 2 decimal, it will be 190.98 meters. In electromagnetic survey or prospecting, which one of the following given options is correct? So it is low frequency is used and alternating current, because it goes like X and other frequency waves, the current is alternating, so it gives you primary field, which is, you know, giving you electromagnetic signals. So low frequency AC is normally used in this electromagnetic methods of prospecting. Just to inform you that we are starting our GateNet online classes and IDGEM online classes. GateNet online classes will start from 22nd Feb, and you can take a free demo for a few days and then decide if you want to join or not. So you can WhatsApp us at this number and take free demo of the classes that are starting from 22nd Feb. Okay, and see you in the next video. Thank you.